All right, Leanne, welcome to the podcast. We're so excited to have you.
Well, thank you. I'm delighted to take part.
Yes. So can you start by just telling our listeners a little bit about you and the roles that you currently hold?
Well, sure. So my name's Leanne, and I grew up in Louisiana. Actually, your family are all very connected to
yes.
me and my family. Grew up in Denham Springs, Louisiana. Great church there. We loved that church and still do. And my parents are still there in Denham Springs, but my brother and sister-in-law are in Florida, and they are part of a great church there in Ocala. And I've been in St. Louis now, actually, 15 years, which is kind of
wow.
crazy. Yeah. I've told people even this week, they'll say, where are you from? Well, I'm from Louisiana, but I live in St. Louis now. I'm like, it's been 15 years. At some point, I'm just
You're
from
a little
St. Louis.
Bit from St. Louis.
Yeah, a little bit. But I've been here 15 years now. And in my current role, I'm an associate editor for the UPCI. And so specifically, that means I lead the curriculum team. And so I create our teaching resources for the church. So I love it. Thank God.
Awesome. What is your background coming into that role? Is it more from the editing side or more from the teaching education side?
Yeah, it's a little bit of both. So I actually, growing up in Louisiana, I have this really cool like backdrop, so to speak. So my mom was a teacher in the public school system, taught in church school a little while too. And then my grandmother and four of her five sisters were educators.
Wow.
So yeah, I kind of
so
have
rich
this,
yeah, with that history.
This big, big tradition of teaching in our family. We have this like circle of teachers at all the family reunions where they start swapping these teacher stories. So that gets to be fun. So I have this kind of tradition of teaching. And when I was growing up, my dad was all about, you know, he came through the 80s and the recession in Louisiana, and all this really tough stuff after the oil market crash and all of that. And so he was really big on education and make sure you get a good job and you take care right. of yourself and all this, which is a good thing for dads to do with their
sure.
daughters. And so I love how I just said we started at LSU, and I was in the pre-dentistry program. Thought I was going to be a
okay.
dentist, which is kind of wild now because
yeah.
I figured out about a year and a half into it, you would have to kind of touch people. And when that
and
sunk
their mouths,
in, yeah,
no
when that sunk in, it took a little while,
sure.
but I thought, you know, this is probably not going to work. And so I went to my guidance counselor actually at LSU. Apparently you get one. I didn't realize that. Anyway, I go show up and I said, what am I going to do? I can't do this. And so they're like, you have a lot of classes in English and history. And I'm like, yeah, I really like that. And they're like, well, then maybe you should study that. And so they did the math and they said, well, you could graduate in a semester and a half if you did
oh, wow.
that. So I'm like, oh, well, let's do
you
that.
A lot of yeah. classes.
So it wasn't exactly. It's weird because now in my role, I have to be a planner,
okay.
but I probably don't just default there.
Sure.
And so at the time, it wasn't like there was some master plan. And, you know, I would see all of these girls, people that would just like when they're eight, they're like, ooh, I'm going to be a fill in the blank. And they like had it figured out. And I was like,
they're called by the
yeah.
age of 10.
I'm like, how does that work? I mean, I was just at, you know, sophomore at college going, I don't know what major I want to be.
Sure.
And so they said, well, you got a lot of credits here. So anyway, graduated from LSU with a major in English and a second major in history, and still didn't really know what I wanted to do.
Okay.
And so I had started a campus job and was working for the chair of creative writing at LSU. It was really, really, really great, wonderful. Dr. David Mann, a huge, huge influence in my life professionally. And he also owned a literary agency on the side. So meaning
okay.
he would help writers try to get their books, shop it out to publishers.
How cool.
Yeah, how about that, right? And so here I am. I'm not going to be a dentist, but I don't know anything beyond that.
Sure.
And so the funny part is he says to me when I'm getting ready to graduate, he's like, well, I have a really good connection with a publisher in Dallas. So why don't you fly out there and I'll set up some interviews and you can interview. And I'm like, oh, I'll never work at a publishing house, which is hysterical now as, you know, every day I go to Pentecostal Publishing House to work.
Never say never.
Yeah, it's one of those things. So I'm like, oh, no. And so I really didn't know what I wanted to do. But I had really, of course, that's a whole nother story. I'd really gotten into church really strongly in college. A lot of people go to college and they have a crisis of faith,
sure.
takes them away from church. Mm-hmm. Well, I had already had that crisis of faith and really gotten off track as a teenager.
Okay.
So in college, I'm sitting in zoology class when I'm in the science major, and this professor's just going off about Christians and how ridiculous it is. And you know, if he hadn't have been so like just really into it, it might have just slid past. But I'm just sitting there, I'm like, this isn't right. I know this isn't right. I know what's in my heart. I know it was real. And even if I'm not doing it now, and even if I can't debate him and all his facts, sure. I know that's not right. It really, of course, I had just this incredible church family that was always reaching for me, always, you know, working on connecting me back into the church more deeply. And so through college, I really figured, okay, this is who I am. I am apostolic. And so at that point then, I don't know what I'm going to do professionally, but I'd gotten really involved in helping start a campus ministry there at LSU. There'd been one way back in like 70s or 80s or something. So we started up a campus ministry, and it was just incredible. And meanwhile, I'd visited a neighboring university for something they were doing, and they had a thriving college ministry at the time. Got there, met them, and I was like, oh my goodness, this is incredible. So here I am, kind of young Christian in a sense, if I've just really gotten into church well. Yeah. And I just get really hooked on campus ministry.
Okay.
And so this is probably not the way most people decide what they're going to do next, but I ended up going to graduate school to get involved in that campus ministry. Got there and they'd had some issues and had become inactive. So anyway, the 2 years was invested in getting that campus ministry started.
Okay.
And we just had some incredible experiences there with in campus ministry outreach and all of that at those two schools. So anyway, I get done and I still don't know. I'm like,
and what is your master's in at this point?
So my master's at that point was in English with a concentration in literature.
Okay.
And so it's really the English track.
Getting a little more focused.
Yeah, I'm getting a little more focused. I like to write. I don't really know what I'm doing with it, but this writing thing's fun, you know? And so I leave there and I'm like, oh my goodness, wait a second. It's like graduation kind of snuck up on me again. I'm not a planner by nature. And so I graduate and I'm like, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? And I got a job. I kind of thought, you know, maybe teaching wouldn't be so bad. So I'm kind of thinking about teaching, but I don't exactly have an education degree either. So anyway, I said, well, you know what? I've been in school a while now. I just want to work. So I started working for a software company in Baton Rouge.
Okay.
We built custom software systems, and I was kind of like the communications director. So I would do the sales presentations and then train the clients on the systems we built. So I did all for about 3 years, and I'm still not sure what I'm going to do with my life, but I know this isn't it.
Sure.
So I'm going to work, and then I'm coming home at night and going by the church and praying like, God, I know there's more to life than this. I know it's not just this forever, but I don't get it. What's next? But I'm, you know, doing what I know to do, be faithful and get deeper and deeper involved in the church. And just a little before the 3 year mark, Gateway College of Evangelism reached out to me and said, would you consider moving and being part of what we're doing? They were starting their journey toward accreditation and wanted to add some extra programs to the college there. And so I had never been to St. Louis, but made a trip up there, and kind of the rest is history. They hired me on. I joined there in August of 2006 to be the English professor, and worked there for 5.5 years. And then January of 2012, moved over to headquarters to start as the book editor, and then eventually moved over to the curriculum materials.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. So that's kind of the journey. Yeah.
Very cool. So it's really cool to see just the pieces of your story come together to where you are serving right now. And our listeners may not know this, but your hands really touch so many of the books and curriculum that PBH comes out with. And so you have your influences seen and felt and heard and in so many different areas.
Yeah, it's been such a miracle journey. I'm just a testimony of God's faithfulness, of his mercy. And you're right. It's amazing to look back and see all these little chapters of life that at the time seemed so isolated and so disconnected. And what am I doing? There was like a period of like 6 months between LSU. You know, I've graduated early. And so what am I going to do for 6 months? I can't get started. And so I worked as a webmaster in the ancient days of when that was a thing. And so it's like 6 months of doing that and thinking, what am I going to do with this? Well, then I can't tell you how many times something from that I would plug in later. So it is amazing how God takes these parts of our journey that feel like detours. And then you get 10 years down the road and go, oh, now I get it. That's what that was about. So I love those details of the story, how they come together.
That's beautiful, especially for someone who's maybe in a detour right now and can't see that end result of this is where I'm going and this is how it's all going to come together. And I think your story is so cool and unique because it also shows just how to keep going even when you don't know exactly or you don't feel a certain like this is the calling or this is where I belong, this is what I should be striving for. And many times it feels like we should have that end result of, I want to be XYZ, either in ministry or in career. There should be a goal that we're going toward. And yours seems like it tells it from the other end of just keep walking, and then the end result comes as a result of that.
That's what I'm convinced of. Now, it's weird because I do think your personality will change as you age and all of your life experiences. Now, I'm the other extreme. I live by the plan, right? So everything has yes. to have a plan. But it really is true, you know, this journey of trust. I remember at one point, kind of that 3 years between school and going on to whatever was next, I just kept saying, God, you know, there's got to be more. What's next? What's next? And it's like I wanted this perfect answer. I remember one time saying, God, obedience is not my problem. I promise if you'll tell me what to do, I'll do it. Well, you know, you've got a journey there that he knows the right timeline. Mm-hmm. And so it's that trust in that timeline to say, sometimes we get the big picture. Some, you know, we all know these people, again, who have these great moments of revelation where God shows them, this is what you're going to do. And that's so wonderful. Some of us, we don't have that exact story, but we just do what we know to do. We be faithful. Sure. We try to pursue whatever God puts in our path next and just trust he's gonna direct it. And he does. He really does.
Absolutely. We're talking about this from the perspective of a career journey. How much of this was a personal journey for you as well, as far as your identity? Because I know that's a big piece that a lot of us try to find our identity through our work or through our ministry. So what has your journey been alongside of your career? How has your personal journey evolved as well?
Yeah, that's a great question. And steer me if I don't just answer it kind of the way you're thinking. But, you know, it's kind of interesting how my story involved finding my right place in my relationship with God at the same time of developing professionally into where I was headed. Because at one point I think it was when I interviewed with Gateway, I had to send them in my transcript, and I'm looking at my transcript from college, and it was like things I didn't even remember. Apparently I switched majors about 6 or 7 times. So at one point I've got like a psychology major on there. At one point it's mass communication. I have all these different.
Where did
like,
all these come from? Yeah, who did these?
I didn't even remember that chapter. So that word identity, I love that you said that, because this deal of figuring out who we're going to be, that's a big thing. And,
absolutely.
You know, you might go back a couple of generations ago when just because of the way the world worked and life worked. And so you have, you know, life on the farm in rural America, and these, you know, 14 and 16 year olds are out in the field working with mom and dad for their whole life. And they're pretty much who they're going to be
sure.
by the time they're, you know, if
their
they get to graduate
very
high school.
Set,
yeah.
Or, you know, they could see where they're going very clearly.
There's not a lot of options. And now it's almost like we're drowning in a sea of options. And that's a good thing. That's a terrible metaphor there. But in all that we have in figuring out who we are and what we're going to do, our identity is tied to our professions. It really is. And sometimes we can take that too extreme, I understand. But a big part of understanding our identity is understanding our purpose. And I'm just blessed in my life that it happens to be that my purpose and my profession get to all connect to my walk with God. I understand a lot of times we, maybe in the season we're in with life, we have a profession or a vocation maybe that is about, this is what I do to take care of my family. And hopefully it's fulfilling and it matches our callings and our gifts and all of that. But I know that's different for everybody depending on the season they're in. I do count myself very blessed that in this particular season, my calling and my profession and all of these things just line up, and it's just really, really great experience I get to have. But that bigger point of figuring out our identity and purpose, I agree, that is so huge. And in some ways I felt like I was kind of bumbling around looking for that. Well,
sure.
We're back to being faithful and trying to keep do what we know to do and learn God through that process. That's part of the deal of like, okay, God, you know, why am I still at this job that I'm miserable in? Well, he knew there was maturing that had to happen in that time. And I'm learning things in that time that I don't realize until later. So it's all part of the journey.
Yeah, that's beautiful. And just, I think also there's a piece to be said too about finding your natural giftings along the way too, because now looking from the outside, it's very apparent that you're gifted at what you do, at your speaking and your writing and your editing. You're just good at what you do, and I'm bragging on you a little
<You're>
bit
<very kind. laughs>
But it's very true. And so how did you find, as you went, how did your natural giftings play a role in the path that you were on?
Yeah, that's a great point. You know, I remember even I'm kind of telling the story of LSU because that was so formative and making that transition from kind of, you know, adolescence to adulthood or whatever that the right terms are there. I remember going to like, they had a career center, career counseling, something, you know, and I remember like maybe taking some tests that would help because I mean, I mean, shot in the dark, no plan. What am I going to do with my life? Who am I? All those things.
Yeah. Toss a quarter or
it's just, you know, again, number. Yeah. All these majors. Oh, I guess I did that for a while. Right. And it was part of that process of trying to understand who I am and that deal about figuring out giftings. Sometimes it is as simple as the guidance counselor saying, wow, you have a lot of English classes. Oh yeah, I really like English. And the guidance counselor is kind of looking at me like, maybe that should tell you something, right? So sometimes the things that we are interested in show us, kind of give this insight into, okay, well, maybe that is part of my giftings, and we have to acknowledge that and embrace that. And then, of course, there's that responsibility to then grow that. Mm-hmm. So for me, it was enjoying writing and then realizing, oh, well, maybe then I'm supposed to do something with that. Maybe that's a gift. Now, it wasn't the same case for speaking.
Okay.
Somehow I skirted through all of, like, I went to a mix of church school, Christian school, public school, did private school, did a little bit of all of that all over the map. And somehow I never had to do some kind of oral presentation
until
I was in eighth grade.
Okay.
Yeah, I made it all the way through like elementary school. I don't know why we didn't do that. We didn't do that. And I'm an eighth grader, but I'm taking a class with the ninth graders.
Okay.
And so there's already kind of that social thing. Yeah, a little different thing.
Yeah.
And we had to write a paper. Cool. Mm-hmm. I'm loving it. And then she was going to have us get up and read our paper of the class. And I didn't even occur to me that might be an issue. Mm-hmm. Write the paper, cool. And we're sitting there in class and they're going down the line. I'm an A, so I got to be first, you know. And I get up there and I turn around to the class. You know, it's the old days of the pen and paper. And I hold that paper up and look out at the class. Oh my goodness, I can still feel it right now. This just bottom of my stomach drops out. Wow. Panic. I was shaking so bad. The paper's rattling, like the whole class is doing that awkward look at you like, oh, what are we going to do right now? And like the teacher was like, it's okay. And then, of course, you know, it's like the whole, oh, bless them, Lord, at church. You know, it just makes it worse,
like,
because
bless your heart.
Yes, you're calling to attention that I'm having a problem here.
Yes.
It was awful. Oh, I mean, thank God I made it through without passing out. It was, I didn't even realize to know that would happen. It's like sometimes, you know, like, oh, I feel myself getting nervous. Mm-hmm. I literally walked up there like life is normal. And the minute I turned and looked at all these faces looking at me, just bottomed out.
Wow.
And so that was like, I will do whatever I can to never have that moment again. That was my MO. It's like I skirted through the rest of school and everything, just trying to avoid that moment again. And then we're back to that process of learning. And even while it was in this job that at the time I'm like, what am I doing here? Well, as part of the whole deal of having to do sales presentations,
okay,
they put me through Dale Carnegie classes. So they wanted to, you know, develop me so I could go out. And so I learned to do public speaking through my profession, which then, of course, then fast forward to 2010 and God calls me to preach. And I'm like, wait, are you sure about this?
Wow.
But fortunately, there had been that journey along the way to prepare with some of just the technical skills to be able to. So, yeah, it's a wild journey of how all these things tie together that you don't expect. So that we've got, unlike with the writing where that's an interest that, okay, well, that must be a gift, so let's develop that because it's fun anyway.
Yeah.
Then there are other times where there's part of the toolkit of what you need to do either your profession or your ministry or both, that it's not something you just naturally just, I love to do this, but you recognize it's a part of the journey and you put your mind to developing that gift, and God, of course, helps along the way. So
incredible.
Yeah.
Yes. And just being able to look back, I think when God is guiding,
yes,
and you can step back and look and put those pieces together and say, this was not a gifting of mine. In fact, it was an incredible fear and a moment of panic when I had to do this, and see how he positioned your career to build that skill in you. And then he dropped that preaching coin.
Right.
It's almost like it was tailor-made for you, because what if you had gotten that in eighth grade? You probably would have said, nope.
Panic. Absolutely not.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so that's incredible how God, you know, shapes your path just for you. Just
true.
Individualized, just for what you need.
Very true.
And I think that's beautiful to look back and see how all of those pieces play a role.
It is incredible. This idea of, you know, there's almost this criticism of like God's the watchmaker who winds it up and then lets it go and backs off. And so some people kind of say that and they think of it as a negative. It's like he's not hands on. Well, I look at my journey and go, no, that metaphor is about the fact that he is so wise and so intricate. And again, put all these details together. And then, of course, I've experienced the very hands on moving around in my life. But it is, there's no way you can write some of these stories. You know, we make that joke, I can't make this stuff up. We really can't. When you look back at the details of your life and how all these things fit together in ways that would seem contradictory,
sure,
it's incredible how wise and perfect God is and the way he weaves all this together just right.
Right.
Yeah.
I love that. Everything that you're saying resonates so much with me and my journey as well. I, too, had a crisis of faith maybe a little earlier than most, maybe as a young teenager, and then went into psychology. And so for most people, I think that would be like, going into psychology, that's where they question you and that's where they test you. And when I was sitting there, everything they said reaffirmed my beliefs as well.
Yeah. Okay.
And so I just thought, you know, this doesn't seem right, or this, they don't even know it, but they're reaffirming what God says in his word through this
right.
secular theory or this secular concept, but it was already there to begin with. And then how God teaches, He both affirms you,
yes,
and grows you.
Absolutely.
At the same time, when you are just walking this path that doesn't seem maybe related to his will, or you're not hearing, yes, go down this road, but you're just doing the next thing you know to do.
Exactly right.
And he prepares you in the process.
So
of
true.
That. And so everything you're saying, I'm just like, oh, that's my me too. I get it. I understand where you're coming from.
Yeah.
And so that's so cool to see that God took care of you in the same way that
right.
he has my journey as well. And I'm sure so many people listening are maybe even putting the pieces together right now of, oh, yeah, maybe I could use this side job that I don't know why I'm doing
exactly.
it. But maybe that plays a role later
absolutely.
On too. And hopefully that builds some faith.
Absolutely.
So I wanted to ask you too, just knowing, all right, you moved from Louisiana to St. Louis by yourself, really,
right.
to follow this career journey. How is that transition for you? Because that seems like from the outside, just a big leap of faith. And even maybe a big adjustment, both culturally. We're actually both from the South and both
right.
are in St. Louis now. So I know there is a little bit of a culture shock there anytime you're moving somewhere
mm-hmm.
different. But how was that transition for you?
Oh, it's been fun. we're both laughing because I'm sure we both could swap stories right now. I will say this is why I love the church, and I am guilty sometimes. I can't even remember now who said it. Somebody said, "I'm an introvert who's trained to become an extrovert,"
yes.
right? And so maybe that's a little bit me, but I sometimes am guilty of, I can get so wrapped up in my projects and my everything. I'm doing life, and I have to stop myself and say, no, we got to slow down. We got to connect with other people. We got to, you know, do that kind of thing. I have to kind of remind myself sometimes. But thank God for the church. And in a transition like that, that's when you realize we need the church. We need each other.
Sure.
We need the body of Christ because, like I said, I had never been to St. Louis. I had met one couple from St. Louis. That was the connection. They had said something, it shared my name in a meeting, and the rest is history. And so, oh my goodness, I remember when I flew up to interview in June and then moved in August. And when I interviewed in June, like the emotions of it that first night. I mean, this is probably the only time I remember doing this in my life. I cried myself to sleep.
Oh my goodness.
Yes. It was just because it's kind of like I knew I was going to come. I was already kind of feeling a yes, and I wanted to come, but it like really hit me. It sunk in that night. And I was just like, it really hit. And I'm like, I mean, I had lived in one house my whole life until, you know, right around college, moved with some friends into an apartment and that was it. And it's just like, whoa, this is it. You know, I don't know anybody in the city. I'm just showing up.
Yeah.
And so we just loaded things up and came, and it was the church family that just took me in and, you know, just learned to laugh about all the differences. They still joke and say how ridiculous I am with some of it. We last night had this discussion. They cooked I'm going to say they cooked white beans. They would say they cooked ham and navy beans. They cooked white beans. Anybody from Louisiana knows you cook white beans and you cook a jambalaya to go with it. They cooked, they call it navy beans and ham and sauerkraut.
Okay.
Yeah. We have laughed about
that. I can say, honestly, I've never had those things, especially all together as a staple meal.
There you go, right? So there were all these cultural differences, and we just laughed about it. But it was the family of God that's bigger than those cultural differences. But yeah, between the family of God and then just trusting him to do something new, wow, it was tough. It was, but it was so worth it to realize, I mean, just right away, this is what I'm supposed to do. This is next. This is for me. This is part of embracing my purpose. And wow. So we're going to do it. And so there were bumps along the way, but here we go, really becoming who God's calling me to be.
Wonderful. As you look back, is there a particular season that stands out maybe as a biggest challenge or an obstacle that in the moment was very hard to overcome? I don't know if this move would be it or if there would be something else, but is there anything that sticks out to you?
You know, there are different seasons that I can think of even right now. And I guess I should give some examples to kind of put it into practice, but let me go ahead and say this, make sure I don't forget. I remember even clear back in high school, I remember in a Sunday school class, even though I was kind of trying to figure it all out and had some issues, I remember an older young lady in our Sunday school class who said, when we look back and see things that at the time were so big and we struggled on, it's easy to get critical of ourselves and say, I can't believe I struggled with that. That was no big deal. Now I can look back. Well, sure. That's just perspective because you've grown now.
Absolutely.
And I really think that applies to all of us. I can look back and think of these seasons that at the time seemed overwhelming. And now I look back and go, that wasn't a big deal. Well, because you're going through it at the time, it is a huge deal. And so the move was challenging. And then there have been seasons in between where maybe it was a professional something that I was working through myself. It's interesting because my journey has been so, everybody's been so gracious. And we're back to, I realize the privilege I have that I get to work in a church environment. I've not had that always. So I do know enough to realize that's not always what everybody, you're going to have people listening right now that you're struggling with maybe misogyny in the workplace or any number of issues that come from the environment that you can't control. And so I realize I'm getting to speak from privilege, but I have been blessed that, I mean, by and large, almost unanimously, I've had this wonderful group of people all along the journey that have been supportive. And so the biggest things that I've been through are things myself that I was struggling with. Leanne here. And so looking back, just being willing to grow and persevere when I confront in myself these things that I need to go through and grow and become whoever's the next version that God wants me to be.
Yeah. Are there any signs when you're going through something like that? Like, I know for me, sometimes it's just an epiphany moment of, maybe this is me. I'm the common denominator of what I'm going through. Maybe I need to, whatever it is, give myself grace, know I'm growing. But recognizing I'm in that season, do you have moments that you've recognized that? Or is it after the fact thinking, okay, I grew through that, you know, the hindsight piece of it?
I wish I was self-aware enough to be able to say in those moments, oh, this is me right now. It's usually after. But I will say this, we're back to the body of Christ. It's having friends in your life that you trust.
Sure.
Because it's usually, for me, it's the friend that is, you know, you have friends that anything you say, you are all, you know, and then you have friends that love you enough, love you even more than those people that feel like they love you the most in those moments,
and
that
know
will
you enough.
Yes, that will say, you're being a jerk right now. No, that's you. And so I think I have a couple of those friends in my life that will be honest with me when it's painful and sometimes hurts my feelings for a half a second, but then they will go ahead and call me on it. And so I wish I was self-aware enough to be able to say in that moment, ooh, this is me. I'm being a bit immature here. I'm being a bit selfish here.
Sure.
I can't say that I'm that magnanimous and selfless, but I do have friends I trust that they have no trouble to be able to say, hey, this is you right now. You were the one in that situation who said that and did that and should have done that differently. So we're back to having that network of people that support us.
Absolutely. The importance of community seems like such a big theme in your story, both positive and then just to be that outside perspective of having a second set of eyes on what you're going through and trusting them enough to be those people for you. how do you now, as a leader in your field, in your department and division, how do you turn around and cultivate that for the people around you?
Oh, I wish I could also answer that with some kind of wisdom or experience. And that's a recognized area of weakness for me. I can get focused in. I want to just do stuff and create stuff. And I just thrive on, you know, writing and creating and developing things. And so I've sometimes heard it said, you've probably heard it said that, you know, sometimes you can be project oriented or you can be people oriented. And so, you know, you've got to have a team that you have all that mix of all that. So we have people on our team that just, they're so people oriented. They have to be reminded, hey, we got to work on the project now. Let's pause being social a little bit. Let's work on the project. Yes. Right. And then you have people like me that honestly, I will get so in depth in the project. I may just live in that world for 3 weeks and not come up for air and notice, hey, you know, Sheila over here is having a hard time and we need to connect a little bit.
Sure.
So unfortunately I'm not the best at that. I'm working on that. Actually, sure. I just recently, as part of my journey, I met with our district board to be ordained, become ordained. And that was one of the things they issued it was not a corrective, but it was kind of a challenge. They asked me, who are your mentors? And I shared that right off the bat. I have some great, great people that have poured into my life. That was the easy question. And their very next question was, who are you mentoring?
Wow.
And that was tough. I kind of did I like to travel and bless churches. That's not the answer to the question. And it really kind of hit me in the face. It's just a couple of months ago. I have not been conscious enough to think about, I guess it's the self-awareness. I still sometimes feel like the kid at the table, you know, at the grown-up table, right? And so now I'm realizing.
We all do,
we have this moment like, oh my goodness, I'm supposed to be grown up now. This is what adulting is. I'm 42 years old. Are you kidding? What? How did that happen? And I'm looking back and going, wow, other people at this age were shaping my life. It's time for me to turn that on and really start becoming very intentional about looking around and saying, okay, what young ladies can I in any way be a blessing to, whatever that looks like. And that may look different. I recognize we have such a versatile, diverse mix of people listening from all kinds of different fields and professions and interests and all of that. This is the wildest thing. I can't believe I'm saying this. Okay, you're not going to believe this. Here we are, the skirted professional. And I got to tell you, in the last year and a half, I've gotten so into hunting. Can you believe that? Is that not crazy? And this has nothing to do with my profession, except it is my release valve.
Sure.
So I make sure a few times a year I go somewhere for a few days and it's with my family. The whole thing came up as a way to spend time with my family.
Okay.
And so it's this release valve. You're out in the woods or I love to fish. I kind of play at the hunting. I'm not very, very great at that. But and anyway, the reason I'm getting around to that, the hunting industry right now is having this revolution. It's turning over the economy of it all because women are starting to hunt in these huge, historic, unprecedented, exponential numbers. And so anyway, I'm watching this develop and I'm just sitting back going, wow, how does that work? And so with social media, I started this little social media for my family and all our outdoor adventures. And so I'm getting pinged on all these things on social media and they're sending me these surveys. And what they're realizing is you have these ladies that are trying to find their niche in this sport that's been, I mean, unbelievably male dominated, obviously. And so they're having to create this identity. Of course, then I come into it with yet this another mix of then I have this, you know, I have my outfits tailored to represent my feminine identity and all of this kind of thing. And so then I'm yet this other thing that they're not sure what to do with. Anyway, the point is, it's really wild. But to get to your point of how do you influence others? Well, I really see that even in this wild little unusual example of hunting and females hunting, what the studies say is it takes one female to reach out to another female. That it's very rare for somebody to decide, hey, I think I just want to go hunting.
Sure.
But when you have these connections, then somebody becomes your entry point. And that's a way long way of saying all of us have to look for our entry point into some new world we want to get into, and then think about how do we help somebody else into our world. And it's so amazing. Again, we've probably got some extroverts listening that you don't know that emotion of what it's like to walk in a room where you don't know anybody. But for most of us who do identify with that feeling, there's a responsibility on us to say, okay, when we're in that room and somebody new walks in, we've got that responsibility to be their bridge and be their connection point.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Everything that you're saying, it paints such a beautiful picture of this. You know, our society today has this kind of campaign almost of women supporting women, and we're going to empower each other. And that is somewhat our goal, even with this podcast, as everything that you're saying, we've heard, Chloe and I, we've heard women tell their stories to us, and we've been so encouraged.
Like, yeah.
You know, you made it through that. Wow, look at these incredible things that you're doing. How are you balancing all of that and juggling all of that? And can you show me the way that you've gone?
Sure.
Because I'm here at the entry and seeing everything that you've accomplished, but I haven't heard your story, or I haven't had that example necessarily to me. And so even what you're doing right now, I just thank you for being willing to share and even be vulnerable in your journey and share what you're working on and what you're going through right now. I think especially as leaders, there's a lot of pressure maybe to, when you step into a role, to just be good at every aspect of that, or just know exactly how you're supposed to lead those around you. And so for a leader to say, this is my areas of strength, and then this is maybe what I'm working on, I think that's really incredibly encouraging and inspiring.
Yeah. I mean, the good news and all that, and that's the, I guess, the myth about vulnerability. And of course, that's a whole area, and there are all these experts talking about that now. So I know that's a big word. But one of the myths is that if I put it out there, you know, then, oh my goodness, that's now everybody knows my weakness. Well, they're going to know it anyway. Sure. So anybody, if you're having the same conversation that people I supervise, they're going to get that. So I think the deal is, once we bring it to that conscious level, that we can start working on it. That's one
and
of those.
Somewhat takes the shame out of it. Of, I have to pretend like I'm a perfect leader.
Right.
Versus, hey, this is what I'm working on, and I just want you to know.
There it is.
You know,
there it is.
I'm being real about where I'm at.
And that's the deal. I hope it can encourage somebody listening that those weaknesses that we sometimes just want to just back off because I, you know, again, whether it's the, I can't speak in public, or I get too consumed in stuff, and I've got to, it's really hard to think about people and be a leader that's, you know, all that, whatever that weakness looks like for whoever's listening. The point of all this is we can work on that. God will help us. We can develop professionally, whatever that looks like. We can't let those limitations stop us from embracing our purpose. There is always a way to keep going forward. My grandfather, one of his last things he said to me, my last visit before he passed, he said, go until you get to the end of your rope and then figure out how to go some more. And so, you know, again, I'm blessed because of all these, we're back to voices that speak into your life. And that was just kind of the mantra in our family, figure it out. And then when it gets tough, figure it out a little more, just keep on going. And so I want to encourage somebody today that, you know, whatever feels like the roadblock or the obstacle, we just hang in there and keep at it. And life has a way, God has a way, I should say, of helping us through to whatever's next.
Absolutely. So you've shared kind of this whole journey, and it's so beautiful. As you're looking back, do you have just a favorite part of either what you get to do currently, or maybe a favorite role that you've played in the past that you look back and just think, that was just the best, or this is, you know, the part that either fulfills me or feels the most natural, easiest? What's just your favorite part of your journey?
Okay, I'm going to tell a little chapter of my story.
Okay.
And we're back to the theme is sometimes mistakes happen, but it always works out. God has his reasons, and we get through it. So probably the biggest chapter of my story that was the most intense was being the managing editor for the Apostolic Study Bible.
Okay.
So I came to headquarters to work for PBH in 2012, and we immediately started working on an Apostolic Study Bible. And that was just huge because we had to find, you know, people that had expertise in, you know, each book of the Bible and all this. It was a huge project, the whole deal, just everything. So it's kind of a two-year deal, and it was intense. It really was. But we did it. We pulled it off. We got it printed. Yay! And it was so exciting, and it was received so well, and everybody was so thrilled to have this resource. Well, it went so quickly that we had to turn around just right away and get ready to do the second printing. And it's like this high point. Oh my goodness, we did all this hard work and it's so successful. It's like our beyond our wildest dreams. It's so great. Everybody wants this. Great. But then you got to turn around and you just kind of come off the 2 year like crazy and you kind of take this little break. And then here we go again. We got to get back in mode. We got to go back to print. Well, the journey to get a Bible printed is super long because with pricing is one thing another. You usually have to use an international printer and international shipping. It's a whole big long deal.
Wow.
So we'd really quickly go back to print. And anyway, the long and the short of it, I can't believe I'm telling this story, is that when we went back to print with the second edition, it was so intense and the timeline was so quick. And I can make all the excuses in the world, but the bottom line was, in the sign off on the final version, I missed something. Mm. And it was a big something. And the bottom line is that second edition, it was already the point it was bound when the printer discovered our error.
Oh, wow.
Which was ultimately my responsibility to sign off on. And it was crushing. That day in the office, when it all came out, the printer called and they start calling and call me back to the back and say, hey, they're saying this, what are you? And we start digging and I realize, oh my goodness, I missed it. We've got this major problem. And it was just crushing. Like I'm sitting there going, well, it was nice being in St. Louis. I guess I'm going to move home because obviously I'm going to get fired. I guess I'm going to move home and we'll figure it out. And, you know, I'll call some churches and see if anybody needs a discipleship pastor. I don't know. What am I going to do?
Yeah,
we're done.
This is it.
But I, you know, I work with gracious people and we, anyway, here's the good news to what should have been just a career ending day. There were some missionaries that were English speaking that needed Bibles, and we found a way to get those Bibles with that issue that we couldn't sell in our market, but that this market, and we were able to donate those Bibles. And we just a few months ago did an article about how that mistake that seemed like it should have destroyed our finances in the division, it should have been career ending for some of us, we were able to turn around, and there were some churches that reached out to us and said, we're so glad you made that mistake because we really needed this Bible and we would have never had it otherwise. So God has this way of taking even those things that are our deepest crisis and turning that around and using it to bless somebody. So wherever you are in the story he's writing for you, he can take even the ugly chapters that are so painful, and he somehow does what he does and makes good come from it. So,
yes. Yeah. It's beautiful. And it speaks to, again, when your story is in the hands of God, who is a redeemer.
Yes.
It's not just this big picture. He redeems your life.
Right.
But in all of these little mistakes, in our imperfections,
right,
and our missteps, he redeems those.
That's right.
As you walk with him. And what a beautiful place to have your faith in. I love that. It's beautiful.
God,
thank you
so
much for everything that you've shared today, all the wisdom. I just feel rich with all of the things that you've shared, but the aspect of community playing such a part in your story, and then also all of these pieces coming together to lead you exactly where you are, able to gift all of us with your natural giftings and writings and teachings and speakings. And so we are blessed to have you in our lives. But I thank you so much for coming on our podcast and sharing your time with us today.
Oh, it's been my delight. God is faithful and he gets the glory, but I'm thankful for this wonderful podcast and the great way it's encouraging other ladies to just embrace God's purpose for their lives, develop their giftings, and become the professionals he's directing them to be. It's so exciting to be a part.
Absolutely. All right. So I want to wrap up with a question that we ask all of our guests. And it could be just knee-jerk reaction, whatever comes to mind, serious, silly, whatever is happening right now. All right. So what is saving your life right now?
Oh, we're back to friends. It's the theme. It's friends. And so it's funny because at the time that we're having this conversation, so our listeners, whenever they hear it, we were having this conversation at our general conference, which is kind of one of the busiest weeks of our year. It's kind of a wild time. And I think we were just talking, I think having been out of practice for a year of not being around big crowds, it's been a little overwhelming.
Sure.
And we're back to the introvert, extrovert, and wherever you fall on that scale.
We were both kind of ducking our heads, walking down the hallway over here.
Right.
Both of us probably, I think, learned to extrovert.
Yes, so. That's so true. And, you know, you get to the end of the week and you're on fumes because you're socially exhausted and overcommitted. And so anyway, the fun part of this question is, what's getting me through this week? We're back to friends. Call a friend last night and talk for 48 minutes about the most ridiculous stuff in the world. But you find those things that refill the tank after you get replenished. And it is all community. And so there we go. We're right back to the value of community and the family of God, and thank God for it.
Perfect. I love it. All right. Well, thank you again, and we're just honored to have you.
Oh, thanks so much for having me.